Thank you. Very happy to have a chance to be with all of you today, especially on this anniversary. I know that there is a lot of wisdom and a lot of bravery, actually, in the room that we think about on this anniversary. I'm coming at the topic from a slightly different point of view than the two previous speakers. I work at the Wilson Center, which is right across the street. I direct the Kissinger Institute on China and the United States here. And so I work for a mainstream Washington think tank. And in general, the mainstream think tanks are not in dialogue with human rights organizations. And this is a big mistake. This is a big mistake. It's mostly the fault of the think tanks. It's not entirely their fault, but it's mostly their fault, sort of for the reasons that Tung Yao hinted at just now. I think that mainstream think tanks are concerned that if they are seen as cooperating with or being in league with human rights organizations, that this will be noticed by China and that they, the black student won't be able to go. And so this I think is very regrettable, and it harms our analysis of China. I think there are issues from the other end too. I'll come back to that. But so I'm speaking today, my remarks are from the point of view of American interests. What are America's interests with relation to human rights issues? And how does human rights fit within a comprehensive official US-China policy? Now, this is one point of view. It's an essential piece of the overall puzzle. It's far from the only point of view. And I'm not here asserting American interests or American policy to say that this means that the points of view or the methods of NGOs are somehow not legitimate. They're wholly legitimate, and we need a combination of approaches. The title of my talk, as I was working on it, was Human Rights Advocacy in the Era of Sino-US Rivalry. This is a big change, and it's a big change in my view for the human rights dialogue as well. With the advent of the Trump administration, although the same thing would have been true, albeit with a different style, from a Clinton administration, there is now a recognition in the national security strategy and the national defense strategy that US-China relations, while they still have some cooperative aspects, are fundamentally competitive. And you can use different words for this. The word that I like is that this is a contentious relationship. I think competitive is a little bit too soft. I think rivalry or adversary is maybe a little too strong for now, changing, so I prefer contentious relations. This is a long-term, strategic, and civilizational, to some degree, competition. And this includes a very fundamental component of values and ideology, which is one of the core features of this competition. So this is a fundamental change. But this makes a big difference for the way that the United States approaches human rights representations to China. Xi Jinping at the 19th Party Congress said many things, but what he was basically saying was announcing that China's period of tutelage or learning or study from the West, primarily America, was over. China can rely on its own tusa, its own wisdom, its own concept of human rights. The period of study is over. The period of cooperation is over. So from 1979 until maybe midway through the Obama administration, it's hard to find the date, there was an assumption that China was modernizing and that the United States and the West were examples or catalysts, in some sense, teachers for China's modernization. Even though China always said no, China always picked and chose what it wanted for its purposes, there was nevertheless, in the United States and China, a blanket assumption that China was studying modernity And our human rights representations were made within that broad framework. The claim was that certain kinds of laws, more humane assumptions, were part and parcel of modernity. Humane laws, human rights are part of modernity, and that tended to legitimize broadly American representations on human rights as part of American and Western representations about modernity. And these ideas go back to the missionary period and even earlier. Now, with a new era in which we have a risen China, not a rising China, but a risen, assertive China, more repressive at home, more aggressive internationally, and which has declared under Xi Jinping the end of this period of tutelage, that is, if you're interested in human rights representations to China, that's sort of the end of human rights as a component of modernity. It's the end of that framework as the legitimizing idea behind American human rights representations. So what's left? What are we left with? What is the broad conceptual framework whereby America, this big sovereign nation, would tell China what it should do about its human rights? Before I get to those frameworks, just a few notes about short to medium term factors. We tend in the United States to be very, very focused on Donald Trump and all of the changes and all of this drama, this sort of Trump derangement syndrome. A very high percentage of Americans sort of wake up every morning and once again set their heads on fire because Donald Trump is president, and tend to attribute all changes simply to Trump. And in China too, there's sort of a Xi Jinping derangement syndrome where there's this focus on Xi Jinping as the source of all policies. I think if we step back and look at China and the United States without these two leaders, we would see that a lot of these long-term changes would still be in place without Xi and Trump. But certainly when we talk about human rights under Donald Trump as a short-term, medium-term factor, there is a question, before we get to this framework for American human rights representations to China, there's the question of whether we're even interested anymore. You know, is America still, the government, are we concerned about human rights in the rest of the world? Are we inclined still to want to be leaders, to be moral preachers, to be exemplars? We do see in a growing number of nations, including Russia and India and Turkey and Hungary, parts of Eastern Europe, the United States, a growing nationalism and isolationism which speaks against human rights. So this is an issue in the United States, and I would argue it's not only an issue for the government, there's also a question about whether the United States public is still as concerned with human rights issues in other countries and with China in particular as it once was. Only this year, Pew and Gallup polls show that more Americans have a positive view of China than at any time since 1989. How do we account for this with all of the reporting about what's going on with the Weichen movement or the growing techno surveillance state or what's going on in Tibet or what's going on in Xinjiang? The evidence is that, you know, the American people and American politicians may not care as much as they did, at least for now. I think that has to be taken into account. And then on the Chinese side too, there have been changes. There is, you know, Xi Jinping presents his vision of China, the China dream, with what will seem to be a great deal of confidence. Again, his declaration of independence from the West, no more tutelage, especially moral tutelage, which the Chinese have never particularly liked. And at the same time that Xi projects confidence, you also sense tremendous fragility within China. But if this confidence is real, why the return to Maoist methods? Why 党政军民学东西南北中党是领导一切？ 为什么需要一个核心？为什么需要一个毛泽东时代的那么多的这些学习啊，那个雷锋运动这些的？这不是说这些政权这样觉得很大，还有一定那个脆弱性，所以有点那个心智方面正义感觉。It's a strange period in China as well. But I would say also in China, public views have changed. I spent a lot of time in China with young, old people, educated, uneducated. I don't sense that much concern for human rights, per se. There is this sort of triumphalism of a consumerist ethic, an emphasis on material, technological well-being. You have now the freedom to marry, the freedom to work where you want, more freedom of movement. When I'm in China, I don't sense an outcry or a hunger for change as I did, for example, in the late 80s, and even in the early 90s, aftermath of Tiananmen. So we have changing public and changing official views. Okay, so back to this question of the framework for American human rights policy or human rights representations to China. On what grounds would the United States tell China that it's wrong about human rights, absent this framework of modernization that I think was during the period of engagement that you discussed was the broad framework? Well, we could advocate for human rights in China just simply based on moral principle, just straight ahead moral foreign policy of the sort that Jimmy Carter advocated when he was president. This has always been very difficult for the American government. I remember when I joined the Foreign Service in 1986, George Kennan, very important American diplomat in the 20th century, wrote an article in Foreign Policy magazine, one of the last that he wrote, called Morality and Foreign Policy. He said, if there is such a thing as morality and foreign policy, he tended to think that foreign policy is about interests, national interests. And he said, if there is such a thing as morality in foreign policy, then one of its hallmarks must be consistency. And we're never consistent. Right? So this is a real weakness. We want to tell other countries how to run their foreign policy on moral grounds, because one, America has its own foreign human rights issues, some of which are glaring and massive, both historically and current. So America has a hard time being consistent that way. And we also have a hard time treating other countries consistently. Yeah, I was in an article the other day that said more Palestinians have been shot in Gaza this year than died in Tiananmen. But there's no outcry. Americans are barely even aware of this. So if you're going to be selective about your moral outrage, well, then it's not moral outrage, right? It begins to look like cynicism. So you could have, a human rights policy based on moral principles, but it's tough to sustain. It's tough to be consistent. And it also involves Americans in moral hazard. And the problem is I go to China, for example, and I preach about human rights, and I inspire Chinese who go out and act on their beliefs, and they get arrested and go to jail, and I get on a plane and I fly back to Baltimore. This is moral hazard. I'm advocating for certain actions that I don't pay the price for. And so this is a problem with a purely morality-based human rights policy, in my view, just to write it off altogether. But it has to be considered. We can also have a human rights policy based on ideas about democracy promotion. And this is sort of where we went in the Obama administration. And the idea here is that we want to promote democracy worldwide, not just in China, because democracy is a means to peace and prosperity. And this sort of broad prescription is not aimed at China, but it includes China. So it's an attempt, it's a way to try to be more pragmatic, utilitarian, as you implied, without being as preachy. And I think that can be a decent approach, but we've backed away from it now. You can also take a view that we should weaponize human rights representations. If we're in a competition with China, let's make human rights a weapon to attack China with. The problem here is that because we're inconsistent, this is very risky. The Chinese people probably wouldn't accept it, and it would look and be claimed to be cynical. And then lastly, I think this is something that we can explore together, is concern for human rights or liberal practices in this era of competition and Chinese power. Not as it was in the past, this also has its risks, primarily as an expression of concern for Chinese as fellow human beings, but is there a role for human rights as a form of self-defense, focusing on Chinese government influence, interference, on American communities and institutions, and focusing on China's spreading of illiberal norms as a way of getting at foreign policy, or a way of getting at human rights policy. And I have some other thoughts about human rights actors, organizations, audiences, and strategies, but I'll save those for Q&A.